I'm Connor Old, and welcome back to another episode of Forgotten Oscar Films. And this week, we're going to be looking at a great class of films, a film Oscar history year that was sort of done before it even started, but with a couple films that are very crucial to how we see films and how film history has sort of progressed for the future. But if you're new to the series, what I do every single week is I look at a classic film that was nominated for Best Picture that has maybe been forgotten. I look at sort of the year 19... I started with the year 1988, and we've worked backwards now to the year, what is this, 1957? And I always choose a film that I believe has sort of been forgotten or lost to time, and one that hasn't been as well remembered as some of the other nominees or some of the other movies that were released that year. I also do sort of the Oscar history of the time, so we understand the other nominees, because I find it's really crucial to understand the Oscar history, but I also give it my thoughts on it, because I'm seeing these movies for the most part for the very first time, as well as trying to answer that central question as to why hasn't been remembered, why this film has been remembered, but something like one of the other nominees, for example, has been remembered. Does it always have to do with quality, or does it have to do to other sort of extenuating circumstances? But starting off with the first nominee here, it's the eventual Best Picture winner, David Lean's epic Bridge on the River Kwai. This is a film that I talked about that it was sort of, the Oscars was almost done before it really began, or at least that's what it seemed like reading some history based off this year. The DGAs, the Globes, I think the WGAs too, and sort of the critics groups, National Board of Review, New York Film Critics, that sort of society. A lot of them really just love Bridge on the River Kwai. Sort of, it won every award, and really, actually, a lot of the nominees were sort of at least set in stone with Bridge on the River Kwai winning a lot of the awards, whether it be sort of someone like David Lean for Best Director, but a lot of the other nominees, 12 Angry Men, Witness for the Prosecution, and Sayonara, the film we're going to be covering today, were sort of the ones that were in lock. That's very much so. Were nominated at all those different places. That was sort of the standout. And then with Peyton Place, the director there, Mark Robson, getting in at the DGAs, it was pretty much all set and done with no real sort of standout, massive sort of, I guess you would say, blow-away box office hit that usually sneaks in later on. We see every once in a while. This year didn't really have one of those. And Bridge on the River Kwai, being a big success, being a critically acclaimed, being from a sort of an established director, and David Lean, very much so, starting and helping flourish the sort of Lean-Spiegel relationship. This is a film that definitely stands in that realm. This is a movie that I think has been sort of shown on TV all the time. It's a movie that most recently actually just got mastered in 4K. So it's an odd movie that people have forgotten. It's, you know, arguably David Lean's best. You know, it's definitely up there with Lawrence of Arabia or A Brief Encounter. And this is a film that I don't necessarily love. I definitely more respect than I do really love it. I'm much more of a Lawrence of Arabia kind of a guy, but still I recognize the sort of brilliant Alcina's performance and the beautiful, colorful, most recently the 4K restoration. I haven't seen that, but I'm sure that looked beautiful. But the film, just in terms of its heat and its setting, is really quite outstanding. And the ending is one of the all-time greats as well. The next nominee here we have is 12 Angry Men, which is a film I'm much more partial to. It's from a director, Masters of Controlled Chaos director, legendary director Sidney Lumet. This is actually his first movie. This is where he sort of transitioned from, I think he did one TV movie, but he did a lot of TV and worked in that space before transitioning over into films. And what a way to start off. It's got such an incredibly tight script with so many layers, and how it transitions throughout the film is so relevant and modern today. Smart directorial choice. It's definitely one of those classic movies, despite being in black and white, that's so easy to recommend. I think in terms of my starts into classic movies, and I think a lot of people, 12 Angry Men is sort of a standout because it is, feels very modern, because it's sort of timeless in a lot of ways. And it is sort of just a simple, smart, tight, really engaging story that, if you want to show people to get them into classic movies, I think this is definitely a one that almost everyone loves. It's very easy to get people recommended into this one, and but despite that, it was actually not nominated for any acting awards. Actually only got three nominees, didn't win any of them in writing, picture, and a director for Sidney Lumet. Despite that, it's a legendary film for sure. And then another courtroom drama, very similar in a lot of ways, is Witness for the Prosecution, from a Masters of Controlled Chaos director, Billy Wilder. Although this is not sort of the beginning of his career like it was for Sidney Lumet. This is very much in the middle, sort of the height of his career. He'd already won 3 Oscars at this point. He'd been nominated, 10 times in the 50s, including, I believe, must have been 3 times for this, for picture, director, and writing. And very much similar to 12 Angry Men, a courtroom drama. So similar in that way of the nominees, for some reason they like courtroom dramas, but these are sort of these two films that are highly acclaimed and well regarded. And while this is maybe not, say, I would say 12 Angry Men is arguably Sidney Lumet's best, I would say maybe Witness for the Prosecution is a well-liked and well-appreciated Billy Wilder film, but maybe not of his best, of something, you know, of a Double Anemone or something like that. But with these two courtroom dramas and then Bridge on the River Kwai, it makes sense that both Bridge and Sayonara are getting all those technical awards and love because they're the two epics compared to the two smaller courtroom dramas. But then another nominee here that's sort of been forgotten that could have done is Peyton Place. This is from director Mark, like I said, Mark Robson, who's most known for doing the Valley of the Dolls movie, which is sort of a cult 60s movie. He also directed Humphrey Bogart in his last film, The Harder They Fall, which is actually quite a good movie. And it's sort of really kind of haunting in a romantic kind of way of Bogart's career. This maybe you sort of project that being his last film, but I think there's a lot of it in that sort of an eerie sort of strangeness that adds to that sort of allure. So those are two films I actually do enjoy. But this film, like I said, got that DJ nomination and then eventually got the Best Picture nominee, but actually only had 9 nominations and ended up going home empty-handed. Mostly this is because it had a total of 5 acting nominations. So it had, I think, 2 supporting actress, 2 supporting actor, and then 1 for Best Lead Actress, excuse me. And mostly probably you'd think they cannibalized each other. The nominees didn't they sort of cut each other out, they canceled each other out. That's why I didn't win any of those sort of acting awards. And then some of the other, you know, picture and directing and writing went to the venture one in Bridge on the River Kwai. But the film we're talking about today is going to be Sayonara, an epic that very much was sort of placed and campaigned as a very sort of prestige-y film, a film that we see every year at the Oscars. It's going to be released in November or December, and it's going to have sort of the talents that everyone's really excited and anticipating about, and sometimes they nominate before they even understand the quality of it just because it's coming from these sort of people. I'm not saying that's what's happening here with Sayonara, but this is definitely the situation, where it's from director Joshua Logan, who just 2 years ago in 1955 had his film Picnic get nominated for Best Director and Best Picture, and then also one of the other Best Picture nominees, Mr. Roberts, was sort of uncredited, directed by him, and it's actually based off one of his plays. So needless to say, he was hot at the moment. Plus, this is also starring Marlon Brando, who's coming off of On the Waterfront and Guys and Dolls. So this is definitely sort of these two people who are at the height of their careers in a lot of ways, making sort of this big epic about the war. We're only a few years removed from, you know, just over 10 years. So, you know, and talking about sort of a controversial, in a sense, sort of topic, interracial marriage, and definitely sort of prestige kind of movie that was placed in the sort of socially conscious kind of a genre and kind of a positioning. But ultimately, what's its legacy? What does it hold up? So I guess we transition to my thoughts now. This is actually a movie that is unfortunately a little bit dated. Say unfortunately, because I think that this film actually does try to do a lot of things. Its heart and its intent in a lot of ways is in the right place. This is a film that I'm sure at the time, dealing with a topic like interracial marriage a full 10 years before something like Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, you know, dealing with the war and sort of potential singular minded views within sort of the military and sort of military politics that sort of debate in a lot of ways. This seems like at a time that this film was very important, and I'm glad that this film in a lot of ways was made. But unfortunately, I think due to sort of over time, certain viewpoints are sort of simplistic and reductive and almost stereotypical in a lot of ways, which is kind of unfortunate to say, because I think this film ultimately does have a good heart, and I think you can find sort of the right message of it ultimately, but that still doesn't deny the fact that some of them times it is sort of roll your eyes kind of single-minded and stereotypical in that sense. But you still have Marlon Brando, who's incredibly charismatic. You know, once that southern accent that he sort of brought to it really comes out, sometimes it doesn't really work. But really the standout here is Red Button, who plays this really heartfelt, sweet kind of a character who just wants the best for his wife and wants love, and is really sort of the central part and the heart of the film. Him, of course, winning Best Supporting Actor for this film, and I think rightfully deserved. Just a really heartfelt performance. But why has this film not been remembered? Does it hold up? Is that the reasoning? Throughout the series, we've talked about, you know, films have been forgotten for a variety of reasons. Oftentimes, their quality, sometimes just sort of positioning and, you know, are they the best of this kind of movie? No, well, then it's kind of hard to recommend, especially with certain genres like screwball comedies or sort of big, larger period pieces or musicals that are not as popular today. So you sort of look at sort of what the best ones are to look back upon. And sometimes if you're not in that class, unfortunately, it's hard to be remembered. But that's not necessarily a bad thing. You know, I think this movie's forgotten, but I wouldn't want a film history without this movie in a lot of ways. Seemingly, this was a film that sort of pushed the boundaries in talking about interracial marriage, talking about these things that hasn't been as widely known or talked about in sort of an honest sort of way. Unfortunately, now today, over 50 years ago, 50 years now, this is just a film that doesn't sort of relate to the views of today, but that doesn't mean it's bad. Just because it's forgotten, you know, a lot of times these films are being played and being shown and being made for the audience at the time. They're not necessarily worried, you know, DVDs and Blu-rays and streaming didn't exist back then, so they didn't even know if people would see it 5 years from now, maybe on TVs, they thought. But this is definitely a film that was made for its time, and I don't think we should criticize for that. You know, forgotten sometimes it can be seen as, it's unfortunate really more than anything. It's not necessarily a negative to the film, that sometimes films have been forgotten that shouldn't be forgotten, and that's why I try to do the series and what I've enjoyed so much about the series. But ultimately, this was a film that's crucial to its time and important to its time, but I think less so today, and that's okay. That's ultimately the message I want to say. And you can still get sort of a great Red Button performance out of it and Marlon Brando and see some really sort of beautiful, colorful sort of a cinemascope, technicolor cinematography if you're into that as well. But that's about it, guys. I hope you enjoyed the video. Let me know in the comments down below your favorite Marlon Brando performance, maybe your favorite World War II performance. I'd love to hear that. And if you've seen Sayonara, what are your thoughts on the film? That's about it, guys. I hope you enjoyed the video. And until next time, stay tuned.